Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. I'm Doug Dean with Schaefritz & Dean. I have also with me attorney Leslie Robertson and Faith Gunderson, who is our marketing coordinator.
Okay, awesome. Well, hello, everyone. My name is Faith Gunderson, and I'd like to welcome you to our Business Builder Series. We'd like to thank you for being here. We know you're all busy, so we appreciate you giving us your time. To make the most of your time, we encourage you to participate and ask questions by utilizing the chat box.
Thank you, and Faith.
Either, Doug, I can introduce you now as we normally do, or I can introduce you when you're the speaker, whichever.
Go ahead and continue, and I'll take over in a minute.
Okay. So before I go ahead and introduce Doug, I'd like to let you all know about next month's Business Builder, which is on February 16th, the same time as always. And it will be an outlook on the 2022 economy and metro real estate market with Roger Totaro. So we're looking forward to that. And that'll be February 16th at 1 p.m. So introducing Doug Dean.
Thank you, Faith. My name is Doug Dean. I'm a owner and managing partner at Schaefritz & Dean. I also have with me Leslie Robertson, who is a senior attorney with our firm. And I jokingly called this class, I love the phrase from Warren Zevon, who's a singer-songwriter. And he said that every problem can be solved with the right amount of lawyers, guns, and money. And for closing attorneys, most of the problems that we see ultimately involve death and probate, taxes, and entities, corporations, LLCs, and trusts. So I wanted to talk today about those three topics. Our class today is just a 1 hour. It's a lunch and learn. So it's just a 1 hour informational session. So it isn't approved for continuing ed credits, which have to be 3 hours. So it's just a 1 hour informational session. Now that said, I think you're gonna get a lot of great information about it, even though there aren't CE credits with it. I do teach three CE classes each month, the first, second, and third Thursday each month from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. And after our presentation, we'll send you a link to a video recording if you ever want to review the presentation. And it will also have information about forthcoming CE classes. Wonderful. Can everyone see the PowerPoint presentation? Somebody nod or give me a thumbs up. That's terrific. Yes. Taxes, death, probate, and entities. These are legal issues that every real estate agent needs to know. I think it is a statistical fact that everyone more than 100 years old, almost everyone over 100 years old has died, and the odds are likely that we all will one day, and the odds are likely also that somewhere in your real estate transactions, you'll find someone on title who is deceased, and knowing how to handle it will be important. So let's go ahead and jump into it. The following presentation is, I wouldn't be a good lawyer if I didn't have some kind of legalese. And I just noted that the presentation is general information for educational purposes. This isn't legal advice, and no attorney-client relationship is created or assumed. We have three topics in 60 minutes, giving a few minutes at the beginning for introductions and a few minutes at the end for the questions. We're going to spend about 15 minutes on each topic. If you have questions, feel free to throw them out using the chat feature. And Faith will moderate the chats for us, and we'll take some questions as we go. I know it says we'll do them at the end, but that's just to prevent a lot of interruptions. If you'll use the chat feature, we'll try to take them on the fly as we go. The first thing under title, death, and probate that I want you to have a working understanding of are some of the terminologies. Leslie, can you go ahead and tell everybody a little bit about what it means to be joint tenants with a right of survivorship versus tenants in common?
Sure. So both are ways that two or more people can own property in Georgia. Joint tenants is one form that people use to simplify things. It has to be specifically on the deed or it does not exist. If it's not on the deed, if it's not stated as joint tenancy, then it is a tenancy in common. Joint tenants is where the provision is that if one of the owners passes away, the others become owners automatically. So probate is not needed or relevant to it passing on to the other two. In the tenancy in common, if one of the owners passes away, the others have their shares, but the decedent's share now has to probably go through probate or administration and go to that deceased owner's estate.
Leslie, let me throw out an example. If you and I held title to a piece of property together and I passed away, it would automatically go to you by virtue of the joint tenancy. You wouldn't have to probate my estate or do anything other than put a record on title that says we were joint tenants. He passed away. The property is now Leslie's by virtue of the joint tenancy. That if you and I were tenants in common and I passed away, you would have to go through steps to probate my estate. And the other thing is, in joint tenants with the right of survivorship, all the co-tenant's interest automatically passes to the surviving co-owners. But in tenants in common, do I have to leave my half interest to you?
So, in a tenants in common situation, I mean, in our specific situation, since we're not family members, I wouldn't be your heir and I don't get it. So I would now own half of the property as I always have, but your half would go to your heirs. Either you have a will or you don't, but your spouse and children, presumably. So now I would own with them. So that might be what we want because we're just doing business together. But if we were married and maybe had other, I don't want to get too complicated, but
you've hit on the point that I wanted to illustrate. In joint tenants with the right of survivorship, when one co-owner dies, the property automatically goes to the remaining co-owners. And that's a great feature to have when it's family, spouse situations. If a husband dies and he wants it to go to his wife, if he puts the deed as joint tenants with the rights of survivorship, that happens automatically at his death. If he doesn't indicate that it's joint tenants with right of survivorship, then it is tenants in common. And then his half interest doesn't necessarily go to his wife. It goes through probate, his will, and so forth. And that was the point I wanted to illustrate, that joint tenancy automatically on death goes to co-owners. Tenants in common goes according to the heirs, according to will or intestacy. Testate just means that the deceased person had a valid will. Intestate means, deceased without a valid will. That's a typo on the form. So testate just means somebody has a will. Intestate, they don't have a will. And Leslie, what happens if you die intestate?
In this state, there is an order of succession, and it's your spouse and children together, if you have a spouse and children. If you do not have if you only have a spouse and no children, it just all goes to the spouse. If you don't have a spouse and just children, it goes to the children. And then if you don't have kids or you've had deceased children, then, of course, it gets a little more complex, and it's in the statute. I can go on, but, I think the main thing is
you've touched on the key point there.
Yeah.
The way that I describe it is if you don't write a will, that's okay. The state of Georgia wrote one for you. Well, it's not okay because you may not want your property to go the way the state says, but by law, if you don't have a valid will, Georgia wrote a will for you, and it's called Georgia's Law of Intestacy. If you die without a will, your property automatically goes to your spouse and children first, with your spouse getting no less than one third. So if you have two or fewer kids, spouse and kids share equally. If you have more than three children, the children share two thirds and the spouse gets one third. Probate is the process of admitting a will to the probate court for approval and appointing an executor. Probate comes from a Latin word, which means to prove. Sometimes I have situations where the person is deceased and the heirs say, well, here's his will. And according to the will, I get it. The problem is that will doesn't do anything until you prove it or probate it in probate court. That's when a will becomes effective, once it's probated. If a person dies without a will or intestate, the process is actually fairly similar. You still go to probate court and say, this person died without a will, and we need to follow Georgia's law of intestacy. The most important thing from a real estate perspective for either probate or administration is that we need a personal representative. When a person dies, title to all their property goes into their estate, and the only person that can legally deal with the property of their estate is the personal representative. And we call the personal representative an executor if they died testate and the will is probated, and we call them an administrator if they died intestate, and we took the intestate estate through the probate court. At death, if it's not joint tenants, all the property goes to the estate. If an owner on title is deceased, their interest must be addressed either through joint tenancy or through the probate process. If an owner held title with one or more as joint tenants, their interest automatically passes to the co-owners upon their death. So Leslie, tell us a little bit about, we've done our title work and we know the property was jointly in husband and wife, and husband is deceased and they were joint tenants with right of survivorship. How do we handle that from a title perspective?
We just request a copy of the death certificate, and then at closing, you have it up on the screen, but at closing then we will have survivor just sign an affidavit that the person passed away, and we'll attach the death certificate. We will redact or cross through really private information because this is getting recorded, and we'll just record it. And that's generally all that's needed. People see that on title and move on.
And that's right. We have two or more co-owners. One of them is deceased. And all we have to do to clear the title is get a copy of the death certificate and record it with an affidavit. And the affidavit says three things. We held title as joint tenants. They have passed away as proved by a copy of the death certificate attached. And therefore, the property belongs to the remaining owners of the property. So that's how we handle a joint tenants situation. The importance of probate, whether it's administered or a will is probated, is we got to have a personal representative. We have to have somebody legally authorized to act on behalf of the deceased, whether it's an executor, if it's testate, or if it's intestate, it's the administrator. Now, the other thing we have to look at is, does the personal representative have powers, including the power of sale? For example, in a will, the will typically will grant the executor, you have the power to sell property. If it doesn't, they have to petition the probate court for permission to sell the property because the executor doesn't have that authority. The same thing with an intestate estate is when they go through the probate court for the intestate estate, they say, and we would like the administrator to be granted the power to sell real property. Probate isn't inherently difficult. The probate court has what we call GPCSF, that's Georgia Probate Court Standard Forms. So it's very form-based, and the forms are designed to be fill-in-the-blank. I jokingly say that you might be able to take out your own appendix if you read a manual and you study, but I don't recommend it. Most things that involve law, there are folks like probate attorneys that can do this for you. So just like I don't recommend you take out your own appendix, it's always good to consult with an attorney to make sure things are done correctly. The other thing to know is probate takes some time. There are periods you've got to probate in solemn form, not common form, because common form takes 4 years until it's effective. So probate and solemn form, you have to publish a notice to debtors and creditors in the legal paper for 4 weeks. So there are certain procedural steps. They're not inherently difficult, but it does take some time to probate a will. And it takes longer now because of COVID, and the courts are taking their own sweet time. And there really is no way to rush or expedite the probate process. Before we move on to taxes, are there any questions about death and probate, personal representatives, and the power to sell property? The other thing that I will mention before we leave probate is a lot of times when somebody has passed away, heirs, generally well-meaning, they want to step in and, they'll sign it with you a purchase and sale agreement to sell the property. Unfortunately, that most likely will not be binding because they are not yet the properly appointed personal representative. So if a husband was the only one on title and he's passed away, it goes to his estate, and his wife, well-meaning, says, I want to list the property and I want to sign a purchase and sale agreement. The will says I'm going to get it, but she doesn't have the power to act on behalf of the estate, nor does she own the property until you go through the probate process. So that's just an important thing to be aware of. Leslie, if there's no questions on death and probate, let's move on to everyone's favorite subject, which are taxes. Talk a little bit about, Leslie, what we do when we do a title exam to prepare for closing with respect for taxes.
Okay, we will, our title examiner will pull tax bills. We will also kind of continue to pull them online if the closing's taking a while, just in case they're delinquent and are incurring penalties.
That's right. One of the things we do to transfer clear title from the seller to the buyer is make sure that all the taxes are paid current up through the date of closing. And subsequent to closing, paying taxes becomes the buyer's responsibility. If the other thing that is customarily done is to what we call prorate the taxes. And all that means is that when we sell a property, the buyer and seller will each be responsible for a portion of that year's property taxes. The taxes are typically billed in the fall for the current calendar year. So today, if you sold a property, there are not yet 2022 property taxes. So what our proration does is it says we'll use the most recent tax data, which is last year's tax data, and we will figure out estimating that for the current year, who pays what. So if we close on July 1st, where we're exactly halfway through the year, and last year's tax bill was $2,000, we're going to say you each owe $1,000 towards this year's taxes. You each own your respective share of this year's taxes. Now, that's great, and we do that on closing as a credit on the closing statement. The only problem is when we do it before the tax bill comes out, it's an estimate using last year. So if we make the prorations using the estimated amounts, the parties agree to reprorate the taxes between themselves when the bill is actually issued. So back to our example, it was last year, it was 2000. We closed July 1st, halfway through the year, and the seller gave the buyer $1,000 at closing and said, here, I've given you my pro rata share. When the bill comes out, you just pay the taxes. And when he goes to pay them, instead of $2,000, they're $4,000. He has the right to go back to the seller and say, you owe me an additional $1,000 because the bill is $4,000 and your half should have been $2,000, but we prorated it using an estimate and you only paid $1,000. So the buyer does have the right to ask the seller to reprorate the taxes when the actual bill comes out. Leslie, tell us a little bit about what happens when people don't pay property taxes.
So interest will run and can become significant. The actual tax balance can be sold to an investor. So that's just where the investor buys the right to collect the taxes. Or at some point the county may, so then you don't pay the county anymore. That, or else the county can sell the actual property in itself in a tax sale. Did you want me to keep going with the slide, or do you want to do the
You're doing fine. No.
Okay.
But just at a high level, if you don't pay your property taxes, one of three things will happen. First, they don't go away. The county keeps track, and the taxes remain attached to the property. And at that point, they will also begin to accrue interest and penalties. Now, that's not fun, but it's not the end of the world. I had a closing where the buyer pulled the property taxes and was aghast. The seller hasn't paid the city or county taxes for 7 years, and they didn't want to buy the property. And I said, it's not a problem. This, we're going to pay all the taxes current at the time of closing, so you'll start fresh. That's one reason that my brother's a doctor, an anesthesiologist, and I told him my job is better than his because I can fix mistakes with money and paper easier than a doctor can. So if there's ever some problem in title, usually the right amount of money or paper will fix it. And that goes well with taxes. If you don't pay your taxes and they get delinquent, you can just pay them with the interest and penalties and bring them current. Where it gets hairy is if the county sells them to an investor, or worse yet, sells a tax deed to an investor. There are still ways that you can redeem the property, pay the investor, and get your clear title back, but the costs start to go up and it gets a little more complex. The one thing I wanted to tell you about a tax deed is when the county says, we are going to sell this property at auction because there are back taxes, and the purchaser at the auction gets a tax deed, that is not clear title. The tax deed owner doesn't have the right to go in and kick the owner of the property out. He has essentially bought the taxes. Now, he can get clear title after more than a year passes, and he follows procedural steps to foreclose, the right of redemption, things like that. So it can turn into title, but a tax deed by itself isn't clear title. Also, the owner can redeem the property from a tax deed. They just have to pay the tax deed purchaser what they paid plus 20% within 1 year after the tax deed to get their property back. Leslie, with respect to what we have on the slide, is there anything additional that we should speak to about property taxes?
No, we just might want to add that the need for a quiet title action to finally perfect title.
That's going to be a little downstream with respect to a tax deed. And I just alluded to it, that a tax deed purchaser can get clear title, but there are a number of downstream steps they have to follow to foreclose the right to redeem from the tax deed, and then a quiet title action to get good title. So that's a little further downstream from us. Let's move on and talk a little bit about federal capital gains taxes. This is what your seller has to pay in taxes when they sell real property. It isn't part of our real estate closing, but sellers always want to know what their tax liability will be. My advice to you is to remember you are a real estate agent, not a tax attorney or CPA. Your GAR contract speaks to that and says, I am a licensed real estate professional, but I am not an accountant, attorney, architect, and that you may need other services that I don't provide. So just be careful. Don't give your clients tax advice. Refer them to the proper professional. That said, I do want you to have a working knowledge and understanding of what happens with capital gains. Generally speaking, taking the specific primary residence out, when you sell real property, you report the sale to the IRS and you report what did you pay for it? What did you put into it? Those two items together are called your basis, and then what you sold it for. And the difference between what you sell it for and your basis is your capital gain or potentially capital loss. And that's treated as income or long-term or short-term capital gains on your taxes. So conceptually, that's what happens when you sell real estate. There is an exception for people who sell their primary residence. And for the average American who doesn't have extensive tax shelters, it's really one of the best tax dodges for the average American is the primary residence exclusion. Basically, if you live in real property for at least 2 years out of the last 5 years, and you don't take business or rental deductions on the property, which have to be recaptured, and you haven't used the primary tax exception within the past 2 years, then generally you can exclude up to $250,000 of gain for an individual or $500,000 of gain for a married couple. So if a married couple bought it 10 years ago and they've lived there as their primary residence and they sell it for $500,000 more than what they paid for it, they can keep all that $500,000. They don't have to pay tax on that gain because it met those requirements. The other thing to know is you'll hear the term a 1031 exchange. It comes from the Internal Revenue Code section 1031. And basically a 1031 exchange is a way for the seller to reinvest all the sales proceeds into a like-kind property. So if it was rental investment property, I'm going to buy another rental investment property. It's going to cost more than what I'm selling this one for, and I follow a number of procedural steps, then all the capital gain from that sale can be deferred. I just say, look, I rolled it all over and I'm not paying any taxes now. And that is what a 1031 exchange is when you hear that term. So the primary residence and the 1031 exchange are two that we see most often for avoiding federal capital gains. Leslie, anything additional you can think to add on that topic?
Did you mention with the 1031, so people know that you have a time period that you have to work under between the sale of your property and the identifying and purchase of the replacement property?
I'll be honest, I didn't go too deep into the details. And believe it or not, there are actually entire 3-hour CE classes just on all the details of the 1031 exchange. So I did want to keep it a high level, but you're absolutely right. And you and your sellers need to be aware of that. There are a 1031 exchange can be done and people do them all the time, but there are a lot of hoops to jump through. You need an individual or a company called a qualified intermediary that takes the sales proceeds from your sale and then pays them back to when you close on the replacement property. And there are a lot of timelines and thresholds. So there are a number of procedural steps, which was more detailed than we could get into in our session today. But I just wanted you to be aware of the concept and be aware that you need to jump through a lot of hoops to do a 1031 exchange. However, if you do that, it is a great way to defer paying taxes. Now, the other thing I keep stressing is it's not an exemption. You don't get out of the taxes. Whatever your capital gain was that you would owe tax on, you're going to pay tax on that capital gain eventually, one day down the line. So it is tax deferred, not tax exempt. Leslie, can you tell everybody just a little bit about Georgia withholding? What happens if our seller is not a resident of Georgia?
If the seller is a non-resident, then we need them to fill out, we need everyone to fill out these forms, but they need to look at our withholding affidavit and answer the questions on the first page. If they're not a Georgia resident, there's a series of questions below that that can still basically exempt them. If they have paid Georgia taxes for 2 years, own other properties, that are at least worth the withholding amount.
Leslie, hold on real quick, and then we can jump into this.
You're
getting just a little bit ahead. We'll cover the exceptions.
Okay.
The important thing
just
for the agents.
Explain what it is.
The important thing for the agents to know is at each and every closing, every real estate attorney has a form where the seller says, yes, I am a Georgia resident, so you don't have to withhold. Or it says, I'm not a Georgia resident, so we might have to withhold a portion of the sales proceeds for the Georgia Department of Revenue. Now, it's important to understand it's not a tax, it's a withholding. It just means we withhold a portion of the sales proceeds, the seller files a Georgia income tax return and determines whether or not they owe any tax. And if they do, this is withholding to pay it. But let's, with that as the high-level overview of what the state of Georgia does, let's talk through a couple of exceptions. Go ahead, Leslie.
Okay. Yeah.
If the property was...
Yes. If it was your primary residence, and you know, a lot of times people have just moved to Florida and literally just moved and they're selling their primary residence.
That's right. So if it qualifies as primary residence under federal tax purposes, even if you're not a Georgia resident, we don't have to handle Georgia non-resident withholding on the sale. Let's jump into another one.
The four-part test is that if you've been filing Georgia returns for 2 years, you'll file this upcoming year that you did for the sale, and you own other you have to own other property in Georgia. It sounds complicated, but it's not. As far as the value, just needs to be the same as what the withholding would be, which, you know, I'm sure it is. So you have to meet all three of those as an individual. If you're an entity, then the three of those plus your entity is registered to do business in Georgia.
That's right. So even if the seller is not a resident, but they can check all four of these blocks, then we don't have to work with the Georgia tax withholding. One thing that you should know is that all sellers are going to get an IRS 1099-S form. And all that does is list basic information about the sale, the price, the date, the property address, the seller's name and tax ID number. It doesn't mean they have to pay taxes. It just says that all the data I have on file is correct, and I transmit that data to the IRS so that they know whenever real property is sold, so they know what to look for on people's taxes. By law, the closing attorneys have to mail those out no later than January 31st, following the year of the sale. In actual practice, our firm and others, we just give people their 1099 at closing, so we don't have to mail it out come January. But regardless, the seller gets one, and the IRS will get that same tax data. Again, it doesn't mean you pay taxes. The seller computes on their tax return their basis and the sales price, capital gain, and whether or not there are any exclusions. A 1099 just says that we all have the same proper information about the sale. Leslie, give us a high-level overview of FRPTA. Leslie, you're muted.
FRPTA is federal withholding, so it's, you know, separate from the Georgia. And for a non-U.S. citizen, unless we find exemptions, we have to withhold 15% of the sales price. So that is different than the Georgia, which is the gain. This is the actual sales price.
That's right. In Georgia, we can do a worksheet, compute the gain, and do 3% of the gain. In FRPTA, we withhold 15% of the sales price. And again, that is a withholding. That is not a tax. And the reason the U.S. government developed FRPTA in the 80s is they felt that a lot of foreign people were buying U.S. real property, selling it at a profit, and never paying U.S. tax. So they said to make sure that people pay tax, if a non-US citizen sells property, they said, we're going to withhold 15% of the sales price to make sure you file a tax return, pay any tax that is due, and then you can have the rest of it back. So historically, that's where FRPTA came from. Leslie, throw out the first exception that might exempt a non-US seller from FRPTA.
So if what is being sold is a primary residence, this means that it will be a primary residence for the buyer. So if the buyer is going to be an owner-occupant and the sales price, and it's both, the sales price is under $300,000.
That's exactly right. So if the buyer signs a form saying, yes, I'm buying it as my primary residence, and the sales price is under $300,000, that's an exception where we wouldn't have FRPTA withholding for a non-US seller. Another one is what we call a green card test that says you're a resident for US federal tax purposes if you're a lawful permanent resident. In other words, you hold a form I-551 known as a green card. So there is a green card exception from FRPTA. The other exception is called the substantial presence test. And the math on it is really fun, so I don't want to get into it. Sure. But you're a resident for U.S. tax purposes if you're physically present in the U.S. 31 days during the current year and 183 days during the three-year period, including the current year and the two prior years. You count all the days this year. You count one-third of the days from last year, and one-sixth of the days from the year before that. And the example the IRS gave is, let's say you lived here 120 days this year, last year, and the year before. You get credit for all 120 days this year. Last year, you get credit for one-third of 120, which is 40. And the year before that, one-sixth of 120, which is 20. So 120 plus 40 plus 20 adds up to be, I think it was 180, and it's short because you need 183 days. So the in that example, 120, 120, 120, it doesn't add up to 183 days during the three-year period using that arithmetic. So that's just another thing to know for if you have a non-US seller that might help them avoid the FRPTA withholding. Leslie, let's move on and talk a little bit about entities and trusts. Entities and trusts are a way to hold title in a name that is not what we call a natural person. A natural person is a living, breathing human being, but that you can hold title in other manners, corporations, LLCs, partnerships, trusts, and the like. Leslie, take it away. I will flip through the slides and I'll let you give your commentary on each as we go.
Okay. So, you know, entities, examples are LLCs, corporations, partnerships. They are created under state law. They need to be registered with a state to, of course, to exist. You don't just call yourself one. So, I mean, this is...
No, that's exactly right. You file paperwork with the Secretary of State, and it is approved by the Secretary of State that says, yes, you are now a legal LLC, corporation, or what have you. And why is that important to us?
Why is it important that it is registered or...
Well, there's two things. One, the entity must be... validly formed in order to hold title. The other thing is we need to look at their corporate documents and know who can sign for the entity. I've got Joe's Homebuyer Incorporated. Well, that's great. And I check the Secretary of State and I find out, yes, there's a Joe's Homebuyer Inc. What I really need to know is, okay, who are the corporate officers of Joe's Homebuyer Inc.? Who can sign for that corporation? So two things to know is always check Secretary of State to make sure that entities are validly formed. And second, we're going to need to review corporate documents to make sure who can sign for the entity and that the entity has the power to buy and sell real property. And consider that this is something that you can do when you're signing brokerage engagements, listings, and contracts. First, to determine if a entity is validly formed under state law, just Google that state, Secretary of State, Corporations Division. For example, if you Google Georgia Secretary of State Corporations Division, you'll get the website and you can plug in a name and it will give you some basic information, tell you if it's validly formed. The trick there is you have to know what state they're formed because this is state by state. I have investment property in Florida and I formed a Florida LLC to hold it. So if you check Georgia Secretary of State, you won't find it. You'd have to know, go check the Florida Secretary of State. And the reason this is important to you is in my Joe's Home Buyer Inc., you sign a listing agreement and a guy signs it and his name is Joe, but you find out later, one, the entity wasn't properly formed, or two, the person who signed didn't have the authority and you won't have a binding agreement. And also make sure your parties are aware. The attorney is going to be asking them for their corporate documents, what state their entity, LLC or corporation is created in, and so forth. And entities have to be in good standing with the Secretary of State in which they're formed. Leslie, I'm going to let you talk a little bit about LLCs, limited liability companies.
Okay. LLCs, hold on a sec. The owners of LLCs are called members specifically. They are not shareholders. They are members. LLCs may be managed. They can be managed by members or by managers. They should have an operating agreement. And that operating agreement will tell you who the members are, the managers are, and what powers they have, whether it is member managed or not. So the operating agreement is sort of the Bible of the whole operation. I can add, people really love to put president, secretary, and all that when they're signing for LLCs, but really they should be signing member or manager. So, if they're smaller, and, you know, I'm getting into too much detail, I do that, but yeah.
No, you're doing fine. The two takeaways that I want everyone to know, LLCs are created under state law. Check the Secretary of State where they're formed. Make sure the LLC is validly formed. And the person who is purporting to be signing for the LLC, you know, say, do you have an operating agreement that says how your LLC is structured? Are you the member? Are you the manager? And does the document say that you have the power to sell? For example, my law firm is Schaefritz and Dean. It was formed by Richard Schaefritz and Doug Dean. We were both the LLC members. And our operating agreement said that either one of us can sign to bind the LLC. So if we owned real property that you wanted to sign a listing agreement or purchase and sale agreement, you'd walk through those questions. What state is your LLC formed? Is it validly formed? And what does your operating agreement say? Is it member or manager managed? Who are the people? Now, some LLCs might say all the members have to sign. So if you have only one of them sign and their operating agreement specified all must sign, you wind up with something that's not binding. And that's why this is important to understand how they're structured and who the proper signatories are. Leslie, take it away on corporations.
So yes, as this says, corporations have officers. So then it's appropriate for them to sign, preferably as president, the vice president, secretary, the officers act. So that's usually who should sign, usually a president and a secretary. We really need to have two officers sign or a corporate seal stamped if only one officer signs.
And that's right. The corporation acts through its officers. And for the corporation to sign a binding agreement, typically we have two officers sign or one officer who also affixes a corporate seal.
And then bylaws, you know, LLCs have operating agreements, corporations have bylaws.
And they outline how the corporation is structured and who the proper parties are for the corporate officers and so forth.
Okay, partnerships, you know, we don't deal with those as often. Those don't have to be registered as far as I know. So that is not, you know, while that would be an issue for an LLC or an Inc., I do not believe partnerships.
You froze.
What's that?
I'm sorry, you froze there just briefly.
Okay. We don't deal with partnerships as often, so I might miss a thing or two. But I think unlike LLCs and Inks, they don't have to be registered, I don't believe.
There are two types. There's you can form a partnership that's not registered with the Secretary of State, but there are other types like limited liability partnerships, which you do form through the state law. So there are the statutory partnerships created under state law, and there's just sort of the garden variety partnership that's not formed under state law. The other thing to know about partnerships is you might have a partnership just consisting of equal partners, or you might have a partnership that's defined to have a general partner and then the limited partners. And generally speaking, the limited partners are the owner's investors and the general partner. And I'm going to analogize this to what we spoke about to the LLCs. The limited partners are the members, the ones that put up the money. The general partner is the one that's responsible for the affairs of the partnership, signing agreements, handling the work, and so forth. So you may have equal partners, or you may have a series of general partners or limited partners. And the other thing to know is partners should have a partnership agreement outlining how is the partnership structured, who are the partners, and who has what powers. For example, in a partnership, who can sign to bind the partnership? Any of the partners? Do you need the majority of the partners? Or do you need all of the partners? Or for a general partnership, is the general partner authorized to sign to bind the partnership? Leslie, go ahead and touch on trusts for us.
Okay. Trusts are another kind of entity, you know, not registered necessarily. They have a trustee that is the proper representative and is the one with the powers to act. And is this is very important, is the one who takes title. So on title to property, it needs to be John Doe as trustee of the XYZ trust. It should not ever be a deed into the XYZ trust. I just want to add that one really quickly. So that is, the trustee is very important when we're dealing with trusts. And we have to review the trust instrument, you know, the instrument that creates the trust. We have to look that over, see who has the right to act for it. You know, a lot of times who the beneficiaries are, you know, in some trusts, it's really, everybody's really just one or two people, and that we may require less than if it's a large, complex trust. So we'll have to review the trust documents. They can be very complicated and long. So we are allowed to, you know, use a certificate of trust, which is basically a synopsis of the trust. You know, it's stating who is the trustee, stating that no powers have been revoked. And this is because a lot of people really don't want to record large trust documents in the public records. And so we can record those.
That's exactly right. The trust can be lengthy. It can have sensitive information, and they don't want to give us their entire family trust document. And I say, I understand, but I do need something. I do need some proof that the trust is validly formed, The trustee is appointed, and the trustee has the power to buy and sell real property. And usually, if it's a lengthy or sensitive trust, the attorney that drew it up knows that will come about, and they also draw up a certificate of trust or an abstract of trust. So they tell them, well, if you go to sell property and the attorney asks for your trust, give them this. This is the Cliff Notes version. It's everything they need to know. The trust is validly formed, you are the trustee, and that you have the power to buy and sell real property. And that's sufficient for us. I don't need to know all the intimate details about the trust, just the legal basics that you're empowered to act on behalf of the trust to buy and sell real property. The other thing to know that Leslie touched on is that a trust is not an entity in the same way that an LLC, a corporation is. And that's why we don't title property directly into a trust. We title it into a legal entity, which could be an individual or it could be an LLC, because you could have an LLC as trustee of a trust. So we don't title it to the trust. We title it to, like Leslie said, John Doe as trustee of the XYZ trust. And it's just important to understand that distinction. The other reason that's important is not all states are like that. For example, in Florida, they have land trust and you can title it directly in the trust. Georgia's is different. And you will see that when you have folks from come from other states and they have a trust, and they don't understand that Georgia is different than other states with respect to how we hold title and the trust. This is the part when I say, congratulations, you have made it through death and probate, taxes, and entities, corporations, LLCs, and trusts. And I hope that's given you some good information so that as these items come up in your real estate transactions, that you will know how to address them. You'll know what to look for with death and probate, joint tenants, tenants in common, executors, administrators, and so forth. So I really want to thank you for giving us your time today. In the words of the Kenny Rogers song, The Gambler, I hope you found an ace that you can keep. I hope you found some good information that will stick with you and be useful to you going forward. Remember that we're always here to help you with a great closing where everyone walks away happy. Our contact information is in the slide. Now, following our session, we'll be wrapping up after we take questions in a few minutes. We're going to save the PowerPoint as a video. We're going to post it on our YouTube channel and send you a link. And in case you ever want to go back and refer to it, you can. Before we close out, did anyone have any questions about the material that we've covered?
Doug, there were some questions I didn't have the ability to answer. I don't know if we want to go back to some of them or get to those later. They're in the chat.
I'm so sorry. Let's scroll through the chat and grab those questions. I'm going to take it from the top. Will the recording be sent out? And the answer is yes. We will save it to our YouTube channel and send everyone a link. I know that someone handwrote their will. What writers or other language is available to include on a handwritten will? The things to know, there is nothing magic about something being handwritten versus typed or printed. The important thing is that when you go to probate a will, it has to meet the Georgia requirements, which include that it was signed by the person making the will in the presence of two witnesses who also signed, indicating, yes, they signed it in my presence. So there's actually some very specific wording. And the other thing that a good will should have, it's not required, is what we call a self-proving affidavit. When you go to probate a will and it was signed by the person making the will and by the two witnesses, you have to go back and track those witnesses down and have them attest to the probate court, yes, I signed that will. And if these were next door neighbors 10 years ago, that could be a challenge. Yeah. But if you sign an affidavit, a self-proving affidavit, where the witnesses sign and it's notarized, that's included, then we don't have to go get those witnesses. We have a self-proving affidavit. So with respect to what writers or language to include in a will, the key things are to identify who will be the personal representative, the executor, to whom your property goes. And don't get hung up about doing that in great detail. Do it in chunks. And the important thing is to have what we call a residuary clause. All the rest and residue, anything I didn't mention in my will, goes to this person. So there's a catch-all so that all your property is addressed. And the third thing is to give the executor the power to sell property, to put that in your will. So it would get going further detail into wills would be beyond the scope of our class. But I'd say, if you ask me what's most important to have in the will, signed by the person making it, in the presence of two witnesses who sign with the appropriate language that they did see the person sign it and so forth, add a self-proving affidavit, which is signed by the two witnesses and a notary, which makes it easier to probate the will in the future, identify the executor, identify how the property should be distributed, and give the executor the power of sale. Reminder, when a couple purchases property, what is the default ownership type? And that's very important.
I answered that for her.
Okay. It is tenants in common unless joint tenants with right of survivorship is specifically specified. And generally speaking, closing attorneys will default when they know it's a husband-wife. They will say, I have made it joint tenants with the right of survivorship because that's what a married couple typically wants. But if you want tenants in common, tell me and I'll change it. And there are times when maybe because it's a blended family or maybe because they have their wills going to pour over trusts in their wills where they don't want it to go to the spouse. In other words, the wife wants her half to go to her heirs and he wants his half to go to his heirs because it's a blended family. So there are some cases where maybe a married couple does not want joint tenancy. How long is probate in Georgia? 90 days. The answer is it really depends. It depends on the county. It depends on the workload of the probate court. And it also depends on who is processing it. If you are following up diligently with the probate court and responding to any problems or inquiries, it will go much quicker than if you just mail it to the probate court and wait. So staying on top of it. The other thing is, and I touched on all the procedural steps required to probate it. You take the will, you attach the Georgia probate court standard form, all the heirs sign and say, we agree this is the last will. You do the notice to debtors and creditors. So following the procedural steps and reporting to the probate court will make it go faster. And specifically, could it be done in 90 days? And the answer is, depending on the county, it could. That is long enough. And I've had others, especially not to name names, but Fulton County, where it's taken close to a year to complete probate. And that was with a probate attorney handling it and doing it diligently. Copy of the slides. Yes, we'll when we email out the link for the video presentation from the Zoom, we'll also send out a copy of the PowerPoint slides.
I think the next one, Doug, was... how does the buyer go back to the seller? Do they have to hire an attorney? And this has to do with after closing, if the tax bill came out and was more.
You know, legally, what the GAR contract says is that the buyer and seller agree to reprorate. And it's hard for me. You don't have to hire an attorney to do that. If your seller is reasonably savvy and sophisticated and cooperative. Some people, despite the fact that they're under a contract obligation to reprorate, they don't want to fool with you. They don't want to fool with it. They don't want to give more money, even though legally they're required to. And that's the point where you might have to, basically like anything, to enforce a contract remedy, you can you know, approach them and try to do it casually and informally. And if you don't succeed, you could hire an attorney to do it for you. The only problem is, unless the taxes are significantly different, it just might not make financial sense to hire an attorney to go collect a few hundred dollars in adjusted prorated property taxes. You can do it individually, and that's what the GAR contract specifies, is that the buyer and seller will work together after closing to reprorate it. And if you have difficulty, you can hire an attorney if financially it makes sense to do that. How about when land is purchased under the retaining tax credit, but then gets developed into single family homes, clawback, payback tax credits? That is an excellent question. And GAR, in the most recent 2022 GAR form changes, went to great lengths to break this down and have the parties specify. So I will tell you, going forward, if you use the proper GAR forms and complete them properly, the buyer and seller will have an agreement. Either the buyer will promise, I understand it's under an agricultural or what we call a CUVA, conservation use valuation adjustment or assessment. And there are two options. The parties can say it is under it, and the buyer says, I'm going to change it. And the seller says, that's fine, but if you change it, I want you to be liable for all the clawback taxes and everything for changing it. There are other situations where the buyer says, I want to change it, but I want you to pay that out of your proceeds as part of the consideration for what I'm giving you. So it actually comes down to a matter of negotiation, but it should be going forward. It should be addressed, and the form should be filled out properly. Now, the other option is the seller tells the buyer, it's under an agricultural use, and I don't want you to change it. And if you do change it, then you pay the taxes. So it's really just what the parties agree upon and document in the contract. Does there need to be an agreement signed prior to closing stating the seller will pay the updated prorations? The answer is yes, but it's built into the GAR contract. If you use the Georgia Association of Realtors, it has all the reproration language built into it. I believe the RE Forms contract version does as well have an agreement. Don't quote me on that, but I believe that's the case. But if you're using other than an RE form or a GAR contract, you'd want to look and see what it says about how will taxes be prorated, and do they agree to reprorate them later? And I'll tell you, there are a lot of, for example, bank-owned properties, and they will strike that language. They say, we're going to prorate it based on the most recent data, and we want to be done with this property. Do not come back to me and ask me to reprorate. So they say, we're going to prorate as of the day of closing, and that will be final, whether it goes up or down. So I think, yes, it needs to be in the agreement. It's in the GAR forms, and I'm pretty sure the RE forms. And if you use another one, see how they address proration. And also be aware that a lot of institutional sellers want to strike it because they just want to be done with it, and they don't want to come back in 6 months and reprorate taxes. How soon can an investor purchase? How long before the county is allowed to sell? I believe, are those both in the context of the agricultural or conservation use?
Those are tax sale questions.
Just a quick note on tax sale. If the taxes aren't paid and the municipality sells the property for the back taxes. Now, there are two things the county can do. One, they can file what we call a FIFA, a writ of fieri facias, which is a lien, a tax lien. But they can also sell by tax deed the property. The tax deed buyer has to wait 12 months because the buyer has 12 months in which to redeem it from the tax sale by repaying the tax deed purchaser what they paid plus 20%. And after 12 months, the tax deed purchaser can do what's called foreclose the right of redemption, which is a court process that said, you had your 12 months to redeem and you haven't, and I want to cut off your right to redeem it from the taxes. And then the tax deed purchaser would file a quiet title action to get good title. There are companies buying tax delinquencies to make a 20% return. Absolutely. Taxes are usually a pretty good bet because usually ultimately people wind up paying them. And so and you can make a nice return if you know what you're doing and invest in taxes. A tax deed is not clear title. That's correct. You'd have to wait 12 months, foreclose the right of redemption, and go through procedural steps to get good title. Should we not take tax write-offs for home offices? I'm going to profess ignorance and say, legally, you may. There's a whole section on when you carve out a portion of your house and use it as a home office, and you can take the home office deduction. The thing to be aware of, and don't quote me on it because I'm further afield than what I really know, my best advice is consult your CPA or your tax preparer on whether or not that deduction has to be recaptured when you sell the property. I don't know the answer to that. There's certainly nothing wrong with taking a home office deduction. The only thing to know is, does it impact you in the future when you use the primary residence exemption from capital gains? And the answer is, I don't know. Does 1031 apply to the sale of primary residences? The answer is, I don't believe that it does. If you have a primary residence, using the 250 individually or 500,000 for a married couple is usually your best bet. But I believe there is a, it's called a like-kind exchange. And I believe it, don't quote me on it, but I believe it specifically it can't be used on a primary residence. Not positive on that. 1031 on properties other than primary residence, exchange company, no primary residence. What if two or more entities own the property? That's a great question. Thank you for mentioning it. It is just as if, what if two individuals own the property? We have to get both individuals to sign the deed, transfer the property, and so forth, right? And we have to do the same thing when it's if there are two corporations on it. So if Joe's Homebuyer Inc. and Bill's Homebuyer Inc. own the property, then they both have to sign the deed. We have to get corporate documents for both entities and find the right people to sign for each. So that's an excellent question. It can and does happen. And that is, that's how we would handle it. And where did I leave off here in the, were there any more questions that I haven't addressed? There was a question here about, can we form a trust for you? And the answer is, it's not something that we customarily do. We can give you a referral to trust attorneys here in Georgia, attorneys that kind of specialize in doing trusts and probate. So, and if the property is out of state, just be sure that your trust probate or trust attorney is aware of it and drafts an appropriate trust for that state. What happens if the property went to probate, but you didn't authorize the executor to sell it? When it goes through probate, the probate court issues what's called letters testamentary. That is the document that says you are appointed as the executor. And the letters testamentary either give them the power to sale or do not give them the power of sale. And what that's based upon typically is the will. If the will included a power of sale and the will's probated, then the executor has the power of sale. If the will did not include the power to sell to the executor, then the executor in most cases won't get it through the letters testamentary either. What tax liability in Georgia and capital gain if it's not your primary residence? If it's not your primary residence, you're just going to compute your basis, your sales price, subtract it, and that's going to be your capital gain. Can you change back to joint tenants with rights of survivorship or tenants in common? The answer is sure. The parties can sign another deed, for example, from husband and wife as tenants in common to husband and wife as joint tenants with rights of survivorship. So it can be done by another deed creating the joint tenancy or transferring it from joint tenancy back to tenants in common. Client trying to sell a house in her dead brother's name. She said her mother did a quit claim, but it's not in the deed records. That will make it challenging because we have to go by what's in the deed records. And if it's not in the deed records, it doesn't exist. And regardless, if he was deceased, I think you're right. It's going to have to go through probate to get someone appointed as the executor. And the brother had adult children. Would the children have to probate? The short answer is the heirs, when a person dies, property goes into their estate, and the only one that can manage it is the personal representative, which is going to be the executor if they probate with a will, or the administrator if they administer the estate and get an administrator appointed. So there are, I think, a lot of variables on that one. And I think it was Dolores that asked me the question. Feel free to reach out to me separately. You'll get an email with our contact information if it's a specific situation that you'd like me to work through with you. Are there any other questions?
Someone is asking about a good place to find templates for operating in partnership. Do you know of any?
Right off, not really. There are some basically outfits that prepare those for a fee, internet outfits, things like that. So I just right off, I don't know the best place to tell you to go buy an off-the-shelf operating agreement. Generally speaking, if you hire an attorney to form it, that's one of the things they'll do as part of creating your entity, is prepare your operating agreement or your corporate bylaws or whatnot. But if you have formed an entity and maybe you did it yourself or it was done previously and you don't have the corporate documents, you can always have an attorney draft them for you or a University of Google and just try to find an outfit that does them. But be very careful. Poorly worded ones are probably better than not having one at all. So just take some care to make sure that you're having them prepared by someone who knows what they're doing.
And always look through yours, because we've received some that had wrong company names in them. It's clearly somebody used a template and didn't actually customize it. So,
yeah. With that in mind, I want to thank you again for being with us today. And as I jokingly say, you've been a great audience. Try the veal. I'm here through Thursday. I hope you've enjoyed the class and gotten some good information. And we will send the PowerPoint slides out to all the attendees along with the link. It takes us a few days to get the video uploaded. We clean it up, add some credits and some theme music, make it nice and get it posted. But we'll get a follow-up email with the PowerPoint slides and then another follow-up email once we have the video ready for presentation. And with that in mind, thanks again. And we will go ahead and close out our session today. All the best to you in your real estate ventures. Keep Shafritz and Dean in mind and let us know how we can give you a great closing and help your clients walk away happy.